Hello. Good evening. I'm Susan Whitney. I'm the Associate Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences at Carleton University, and it gives me great pleasure to welcome you to this second CU in the City event of the academic year. The CU in the City series brings research and scholarly discussion into the Ottawa community. And tonight, we are especially pleased to sponsor this timely forum on architectural transformation in Ottawa. And at this point, I'm going to turn you over to Andrew Waldron, who's going to be our host and moderator for tonight.
Wonderful. Okay, thank you very much, Susan. So the evening is going to be a very informal evening. We have a wonderful panel that I will introduce. But first of all, I want to thank you, and I want to thank the Faculty of Arts and Social Science, and see you in the city. This is who are the organizers behind this event, and I don't see Sarah. Sarah is right there, so put up your hand, Sarah, please. And Nick, where is Nick? Nick is way at the back, and these two really made this happen. Okay, so give him a round of applause, actually. So the format for this evening is going to be light, tight, and full of insight. That's my way to start things. So why have an evening like this? As Peter Clues said last week about the addition to the Château Laurier, we should be having a conversation. Well, this is a conversation. Not in the news or on social media, but here with people interested in intelligent conversation. And if any of you, and I noticed this online as I watched about the Château Laurier, if any of you internet trolls are in the audience right now, well, thank you very much for coming out this evening. Indeed, this evening is about listening to many voices, not one-sided reaction, but a real discussion on the question of how to think about contemporary additions to historic buildings. This topic is not new. Consider Rome's Teatro Marcello. It was added to create a fortress and then a palace. Started down as a theater. The Ottomans, they essentially transformed the Parthenon. Now they've transformed it back to the Parthenon, but at the time they had a mosque in it. There has been 21 additions to the Louvre since the mid-16th century, not including I.M. Pei's controversial 1988 alteration. So buildings and places evolve. They're not static in time. Once in a while, they may need a doctor to fix them and make sure they are in working order. But sometimes you have the plastic surgeon who comes along and really changes a building for better or for worse. So today we are willing to buy the latest phone, but obsolescence of buildings is in fact becoming rare. Our urban environments are places and of variety and can be transformative and evolutionary. There is no need to sacrifice the embodied energy of a place to satisfy the present generation and deny a future generation of keeping a legacy of their identities. So this ethic can be seen in a number of additions, and you were seeing it before when the presentation was going through a loop of images, a number of additions, insertions, juxtapositions, superimpositions, and weavings into new and old, and this is happening around the world. In fact, around half of the construction industry today in Canada is on existing building. It's not new construction, and I think it's increasing, in fact. So my question, and the reason why we have organized this evening, is to consider what is a successful intervention to a historic building. We have policies, we have guidelines, we have charters, we have bylaws, committees, and public consultations. But at the end of the day, are these places better for their interventions? How do we balance the new with the old and not be slavish copyists? Now, my favorite architect is Carlo Scarpa. And he pondered, quote, "The problem of historical materials, which we can never ignore but can't imitate directly either, is an issue that always concerned me. He was conscious of not reproducing the old. As he said, stupid imitations of that sort always look mean. Buildings that imitate look like humbugs, and that's just the way they are. Of course, and I think maybe no offense, Mathieu, but he also said, I've had nothing but trouble from the planning rules of the city and the bureaucracies that interpret them. However, Scarpa was not interested in restoration work, but in historical clarity and making history visible by overlaying fragments of construction. And this is the challenge for architects who work with older buildings. How to balance contemporary form making with historical clarity. And so hopefully, our distinguished panelists here this evening can trigger that conversation. I want you to participate in that conversation. We have a wide range of panelists, each with their own unique experience and position to take on that topic. So the format's going to be, each of the panelists is going to have 5 minutes to speak. In fact, they won't go overboard because I brought my trusty to cut you off. Some of them are, you know, they may go on for, no. And each presenter has they had the option of choosing an image to summarize their ideas. And that's, in fact, what we've got up there. But first, okay, so there is my image. And I wanted to choose something a little more provocative. I couldn't resist beginning with this image of the OCAD, the Ontario College of Art and Design, by Will Allsaints. It's a playful, levitating monument, box with a massive coloring pencils, essentially, or stilts, holding it above a three-story red brick modern building built in 62. So you can't really explain how an out-of-scale, non-contextual mega box is surprisingly now, 10 years later, very well liked. Was it Toronto's Pompidou? Maybe that's the case. Maybe not. But it was embraced in the community, and fast forward to today, and you have this fellow, Rob Shostak, who was a graduate of OCAD, and he was a, let's say politely, a Toronto-hating Montrealer, who came to Toronto, saw this building, and was interested in coming to the school. And so, is it a great addition? Is it not? We shall see tonight. Does it comply with any standards? Maybe not, but it's got a good history so far. So let's introduce the panel. Okay, so I'm going to introduce them first. They'll give their 5 minutes, and then we'll move to questions afterwards. So first we have Victoria Angel, eminent heritage conservator, and all-around diplomat of historic places from ERA Architects. So give her a round of applause. Then we have Peter Kaufman, professor and architectural historian at Carleton on anything Gothic. In fact, did you not notice the lovely lecture? Except without the fashion of Horace Walpole or the makeup of The Cure's Robert Smith. It's pretty close, eh? That's not bad. Sarah Gelbart, I love her. This is how she describes her. Part punk planner, architect, and activist. And architect, didn't I say that? An architect. Okay, there's an anarchist in the room. Okay. I've written with a fixation on brutalism. But then she can soften that brutalism with public performance. Pretty good. Rodney Wiltz, a sustainability guy from Windmill Development, with an interest in creating a world where Donald Trump would be at a loss for words. That's not bad. Susan Ross, architect, scholar, and professor at Carleton, who has worked in conservation for her career by taking Montreal and then taking Berlin. I thought you'd like that. Before coming to Ottawa. And finally, at the end of the panel here, we have Mathieu Fleury, a counselor who was born, I'm going to really tease you here, born when Madonna's Like a Virgin was a hit. He was elected to office to help his community bring better urban cycling, reduce homelessness, and who is itching to be one of the first to ride the LRT. Yeah? Okay. So let's give them a round of applause. And now we'll begin.
I'll just use this one. So thank you very much, Andrew, for that for this invitation to take part in this very topical discussion and for that introduction. So I think I'd like to just start with the question that you posed, which is how do we measure success here? And I'll just reframe that to ask, you know, really what are the goals when we're engaged in adaptive reuse and rehabilitation? So that's, I think, where I started my reflection. And I would say from my own personal perspective, I think the goal is really, it's about sustaining, reinforcing and strengthening the connections that people have to place. These connections can take many forms, and they can operate at many different levels, from the local to the national to even sometimes the international. And sometimes when that connection has been broken, the goal may be to recontextualize the place and reconnect people to it. And I believe that done well and done with a great deal of thought, that marriage between old and new can actually really help to achieve this. However, I also believe that this requires a very deep engagement with a site and with the people who have an interest in it, and it also requires a very multi-dimensional understanding of a place. So the image that I've got on screen that I chose to talk about is the West Block on Parliament Hill. This is an image that was that appeared in the Ottawa Citizen, showing the courtyard, which is in the process of transformation. Why I chose to talk about this is a project that I was very involved with for a period of 6 years. I was actually the bureaucrat on this project. I was the heritage authority, and really it was an extraordinary learning experience for me to be reviewing proposals to alter this building, and I consider it to be a real model project that we can all learn from. So I just want to talk very quickly about the things that I took away from the experience of working on this. So first of all, I think the project benefited from an extraordinarily deep understanding of the geographical, cultural, and symbolic context for this building. There was something called the long-term vision and plan for Parliament, for the parliamentary precinct that preceded this project. And this plan really explored the context, not just from a physical perspective, but also this context with respect to its rituals and its ceremonies. And there was also a great deal of consideration given to people's contemporary perspectives of Parliament Hill. There was also a very rigorous and thoughtful interpretation of the ideas that informed the original design. And so the architects, FGMDA, today they're called EVOC, they explored the high Victorian Gothic architecture of the West Block from many perspectives, with respect to craftsmanship, with respect to forms generated from nature. They explored the high Victorian interest in progressive history, innovation, technological progress. There are also questions about how national identity was being expressed in architecture. And it was really through this kind of exploration that ideas, that I guess an architectural dialogue was developed between old and new. And finally, this project also involved a very thoughtful reconceptualization of this place. with respect to the new program and new rituals. And in this case, it involved taking an underutilized, almost unutilized courtyard of a building and transforming it not in, only into really the heart of a new complex, but really the heart of our government. So that was an extraordinary, I guess, reflection on the part of the team. So these are just some of the approaches, I think, that really made this work. I just want to say really quickly, Andrew asked any number of questions in his correspondence with us, and there was a question about, I think, the role of principles and guidelines, and that's been something that's been discussed quite a bit in the media recently. How do principles and guidelines, how are they employed on these kind of projects? And I'd say while they provide essential parameters in rehabilitation and adaptive reuse, and they were certainly used very thoughtfully in this project, they themselves are really devoid of meaning on their own. And the worst thing we can do is to approach conservation and rehabilitation in a formulaic way, just using rules. I think that's a terrible thing. And I'll cut it off there.
This one's okay.
Thank you, Andrew. And actually, I just want to first to thank Andrew and thank Sarah and Nick and everyone at FAST who put this on. And of course, thank you all for coming as well. It's great to have this event. I just wanted to try to toss out three ideas to add to the mix tonight before Andrew gives me the hook. And they're three fairly broad ideas that might inform some of what we discuss later. The first thing I want to talk about is, in very broad strokes, some of what is at stake when we contemplate altering a historic building, or in some cases even demolishing a historic building. And we tend to couch this in aesthetic terms, and that's fair enough, and that's important. But one of the things we talk about a little bit less is our sense of community, and I think that's one of the things that's at stake. And what I mean by that is that as human beings, of course, we look for other human beings to form groups with, and I think we tend to form a community in our place with the people around us, and coming together tonight is one example of that. But I think it's also natural and normal and not at all unusual and healthy for us to try to forge some sense of community that extends through time as well, that looks back. We want some sense of connection with people who preceded us. And one of the great virtues, I think, of heritage architecture is that it's one of the most tangible and even one of the most visceral ways that we can forge that sense of community with people who extend through time. And so when we're contemplating making alterations to a historic building, one of the fundamental questions we have to ask ourselves is, to what extent are we willing to undermine that sense of community by altering this historic building and altering this visceral connection we have with the past? So I think that's one of the overarching questions that, for me, helps me determine whether or not I think an alteration is working or not working. And it's not just about what's beautiful or ugly, or I hate this or I love that. It's also about something, I think, maybe a little more profound. The second point I want to make is that this sort of issue forces us to consider whether we're really serious in Ottawa about heritage conservation and what we mean by that. And what I mean is, take a purely hypothetical situation. Let's say we had a much-loved heritage building and a developer proposed to make a large addition to it that looked very different from the rest of it. And everyone was appalled at what was planned. I say this purely hypothetical. And everyone said, no, that's appalling. Go back for a couple of months and think about it and see if you can come up with a less appalling solution to this problem. And let's say they went away and thought about it for a couple of months and came back and said, here's a solution that we think is less appalling. Now, is that really an adequate process for heritage conservation? Because to me, that is not actually heritage conservation. That is heritage damage control. And I think we have to ask ourselves, are we willing to settle for heritage damage control? Or are we serious about heritage conservation? And some of the stuff that's in the news right now is a perfect test of our conviction there. And the last point I want to make, which will actually relate to both what Andrew said and some of what Victoria said, is that as, yes, the image is up there now, as well as the URL for my blog, by the way, but I put up four different images there from four different periods. There's a medieval one, there's a Renaissance building, and there's a couple of 20th century ones, one in England, one right here in Ottawa. And I do this to echo what Andrew was saying earlier. This is not a new problem. Pretty much from the time we started making buildings, we started making changes and alterations to buildings. And for many, many centuries, architects have had to grapple with the problem of, well, how do we do this? What's the right way to do this? What are maybe some of the wrong ways to do this? And as Victoria was saying, there is no one-size-fits-all solution to this, and never will be. But looking at examples like the one on the screen, I was trying to think of, are there any principles that seem to unite solutions that, to my mind anyway, are more successful and endure? And there are perhaps a couple. And one is, in the more enduring solutions to this, I think the new addition understands the architectural language of its predecessor, is sensitive to that architectural language and speaks to it. Doesn't necessarily speak the same language, but responds to it and speaks to it in an understanding way. And the other point is that I think in the more successful editions, each one has thought about and understands and has a clear vision of the kind of relationship that it needs to have to that older fabric. And I think what Victoria was describing with the West Block is a superb example of really thinking about both of those principles. And some of what we've been reading about the news in the news lately is a really good example of not thinking about those issues.
Okay. Thank you again for the invitation, and it's lovely to know that I'm not the only person interested. You kind of, as a PhD student, think, sit in a room and you think nobody else is interested in the same things you are, so it's nice to have a big audience. Over the past 2 years, I've become a pretty vocal advocate for preserving and celebrating concrete, modern, and brutalist architecture in Ottawa. After the dramatic implosion of the Sir John Carling building in 2014, it struck me as strange that there were crowds of people gathered to celebrate and enjoy the spectacle of the demolition of a designated federal heritage building. Those words, designated federal heritage building, or even the suggestion that those words should be applied to the to any other building, usually results in huge controversy and protest if there is even the suggestion that we alter, let alone demolish, a building. And while I was thinking about all of this, the announcement was made about the facelift for the National Arts Center and the most recent round of attacks on the eyesore of a main branch of the library that was being mobilized to justify the new Central Library. So why do we care so little, or why do we love to hate these buildings so much? If you look at photographs of the city post-war, you realize a pretty staggering amount of the city was built between the 1950s and 80s. We think of postcard shots of the canal and Parliament, but Ottawa's built heritage is probably more accurately represented in the post-war years, which represent some of Canada's and Ottawa's most notable architecture and architects. But we don't tend to think of these as historic or heritage buildings. Now, a one-woman protest isn't likely to stop the bulldozer, so I've been more focused on trying to share my love for these buildings and help people appreciate them and their historic and artistic significance, even if we think they are ugly. I personally think they're beautiful and also try to help others see what I see, but at the end of the day, I think beauty is one of the least compelling arguments. I admit brutalist architecture is the kind of face that only a mother could love, or maybe the kind of building that only an architect could love. At least at first sight, I very much feel that it is like being told your blind date has a great personality. That's usually code for he's ugly, but it's usually also code for he has a great personality. Speaking of motherly love, academics are often told the first test of your argument is whether you can convince your mother. And I think my mom finally got it, and I swear this is a direct quote from one of her emails. Sarah, I think you're a bit brutalist yourself. Bold, brash, strong, and maybe a bit confrontational on the outside, and something quite different inside. Thanks, Mom. But it's actually pretty funny how often I now get messages from people along the lines of, this ugly building made me think of you. And I'm pretty sure that it's meant as a compliment, or I'm taking it that way. I think Brutalist buildings have spectacular, dramatic, multi-layered, rich personalities, and when placed in the context of historical moments and the surrounding cultural values, you fall in love with them. This is what I try to do with my Brutalist architecture walking tour, and it's been pretty successful. Most people start the tour admitting that they're not fans and never really liked the NAC. I narrate the tour with a mix of aesthetic appreciation, pointing out cool ways the building is put together, the ways shadows fall, the variety of textures, the geometry, also the historical context of Ottawa post-war, the growing civil service and cultural investment with the centennial, and also, oddly enough, showing how it relates to another part of Ottawa that Ottawans love to hate, the Greber Plan. It seems that moving through the space and connecting to it not only physically but through narrative, in an hour and a half with me and through these buildings, people start to get it. They don't necessarily love them, but they find ways to appreciate them. The greatest compliment and satisfaction is when people tell me they enjoy seeing these spaces through my eyes. So maybe you can understand why I find the term the NAC's facelift a pretty apt but also pretty disgusting terminology. I think it points to one of the greatest flaws with modern alteration of historic buildings. We are obsessed with facades and pretty limited definitions of architecture. We flatten architecture down to curb appeal. We want it to look pretty in postcards, a bit of makeup or fresh coat of paint to spruce it up, or full reconstructive surgery if we think it's too ugly to be salvaged. In the case of the NAC, this is especially problematic because the building doesn't even have a face. Like the John Carling building, it was also a registered federal heritage site. The NAC's designation actually points to this unique architectural quality of the ways in which the meandering terraces form a landscape that integrates it into the surrounding urban environment. So how do you give a facelift to a building without a face? You basically stick a pair of sunglasses on it, which is probably the best analogy I've heard of the proposed renovations. To be clear, I'm not against renovating the NAC. It is not a perfect building. I don't think that cities should be put under glass, and the double entendre is very much intended. Cities change. They need the needs of the institutions change, the surroundings change, technology changes, the building ages and needs repairs, retrofitting and renovations. But one of the questions that was put to me, to put the panel, was, are these old Ottawa buildings being successfully transformed into new spaces, and what factors determine perceived success? The contemporary approach on paper to heritage intervention is that the new should be clearly distinguishable from the original building, preferably reversible, and the new intervention should speak to and with the original architecture, be respectful, and hopefully help to frame and emphasize its notable qualities. From the plans and renderings, I think the present renovation fails to do that. I think primarily because they fail to consider the building as having qualities and values worth preserving beyond its appearance. There is a woeful number of missed opportunities to highlight and reinforce what makes old buildings beautiful and great and useful and interesting. I want to make the case that the successful transformation of old buildings into new spaces are more likely when we understand the building not just in terms of architectural style, because things go in and out of style and back again. We should take the time to consider the whole ugly character, his great personality. Old and new architecture is more than just a pretty face.
Oh, look at that. Perfect.
Not bad. And now we'll have Rodney.
Yeah, thanks for hosting me. Thanks to the organizers of this event. I feel very humbled being on such a panel of esteemed experts and looking out on the crowd and seeing people like Mark Brand and Sally Coots, who have infinitely more knowledge about heritage than I do. And I'm so I feel very humbled and a little bit nervous to be on the panel here speaking about these issues as a private sector real estate developer. Now, we have had our fair share of experiences with repurposing heritage assets. We did a project at the end of Spark Street called Cathedral Hill in conjunction with Christchurch Cathedral. We're doing a church redevelopment right now in Toronto where we're repurposing a church into condos and redeveloping the parking lot next to it. And the project that what the picture shows here is our ZB project. And ZB is a site that has such an incredible, rich history to it. It really is, I think, I always say it encapsulates the history of the Ottawa Valley. It
the national capital region, and in many ways it encapsulates the history of the country of Canada. It was the stopping ground for Algonquin traders who used the Ottawa River as the kind of 4-1 of the time, and they would stop at the Chaudière Falls and portage around there, which is why we have Rue Portage on the Gatineau side. The first European settler who came here to settle full-time with Philemon Wright, and the place he stopped and settled was where the ZB development is. And of course, some of Canada's first multinational successful entrepreneurs, people like E.B. Eddy and J.R. Booth, made their name at those sites. These sort of fabulous and terrible at the same time immigrant success stories, people like E.B. Eddy showing up penniless and taking offcuts from the mills, and him and his wife making matches in their kitchens and selling them on the street corners, and growing to be this tremendous entrepreneurial success story, and an environmental disaster all at the same time, denuding much of the Ottawa Valley in the process. But also a great history with people like Denal de Charron and Joe Montferrand, who worked on the site. Denal de Charron is an untold story, but she was she founded the first women's union in Canada. She worked as a matchmaker, les alimentaires, on the site, and matchmaking, not as romantic as it sounds. She was actually making the matches, very dangerous work, low-paid work, mainly women doing it, and she took on not just the executives, but the Catholic Church at the same point in time. And so it has this incredible rich history, and it had been behind barbed wire for such a long period of time. And now our challenge is how do we take some of these great industrial assets and use them to tell that story of the site. And I don't have a lot of answers on how we do this, or guidelines or principles or those kinds of things. But from a private developer point of view, economically, they're disasters. The buildings that we're aiming to repurpose basically show zero return, but they're such important buildings. You know, Jane Jacobs had that quote about new ideas require old buildings, and we really believe that. These old buildings create the story, create the narrative, tell us who we are as a community and as a people and as a country, as a nation. And so, you know, I think when we look at the lens about how do we adapt these spaces, these incredible spaces that when you look at them, when I'm in these buildings, one of my great regrets, I've spent so much time in these, wandering around in these old buildings, is they really do have ghosts. And one of my great regrets is never seeing them fully in use, never seeing them when, you know, 600 guys were going away at working at the in the paper factory, or the women counting out the sheets of paper or making the matches. It would have been such an incredible sight. And so one of the ways, or the lenses that we look at, and it's a pretty simplistic lens, is how can we adapt these buildings? And we need to adapt them in terms of making them viable for people to be able to use them, to try and meet our sustainability standards, the zero ZB. We're aiming for that to be a zero carbon community, so that's not an easy challenge when you're dealing with these old buildings. But how do we adapt these buildings in a way that they still tell that story, that when people wander through, they still hear those ghosts, and they still are intrigued enough to think about who came here before me, and who was Denal de Charron, and who was Joe Montferrand? There was a great quote I heard years ago from Christopher Alexander, who was the guy who wrote Pattern Language, and he was talking about his school of architecture and how he makes decisions. And the question he always asked himself, he said, "I'm not a religious man, but the question I always ask myself is, what would honor Providence more? So should the window go here, or should the window go there? Should it be a hip roof for a gable roof?" And the question he asked himself, a kind of philosophical, spiritual question, is, what would honor Providence more? And the question we ask ourselves as we think through these adaptations was, you know, what would honor those people who came before us? And I think people like Denal de Charron or Joe Montferrand or E.B. Eddy or J.R. Booth or the people who came before them wouldn't be dogmatic and would be bold and would make bold moves.
So the photo that you can see on the screen is the congregation, Beth Shalom Synagogue, Community Center, and School on Chapel Street at Rideau, which this photo was taken in 2014, about a year before the complex, which had been built between 1952 and 1959, was demolished. The site has been empty since late June 2015, and Trinity Development Corporation's plans for the site include two 25-story towers of condominiums above a 2 to 9-story podium that will contain a large grocery store and other commercial uses. So the reason the picture is up here in this discussion around how we deal with historic buildings is I'd like to make a place in this discussion tonight of the city's transformation through architecture for demolition and for discussing demolition, which is arguably the most common fate in whole or in part for most of the city's built fabric. Unfortunately, I'm not making a plea for demolition here. I just think we need to talk about it. I believe we need to engage with the anger, the sense of loss and material waste, and also in some cases, admittedly, the benefits of erasure. So I think demolition is a big subject we need to talk about. And not all demolitions are the same, of course, so I think that the individual stories are important to tell, both in the short term to address this unsettling that we feel of the past, and in the longer term to address how the opportunities these demolitions presented have been used. So specifically, building on the story of this site, I have three main points or sort of calls that I want to make. The first is that I think we have to think about how to engage in creative deconstruction instead of feeding urban landfill. My second point is that I think that there's a lot to be learned from the city's post-war community heritage, social significance, and relatively modest aspirations and environmental qualities, which you often see in these schools and religious buildings, relating to this idea of a sense of community that was already mentioned a couple of times. And the third is to focus the discussion on the critical role that I think the urban design for what's to come on the site is going to have in responding to what I see are changing scale of what the city will be like and also the climate of the city. So for lack of time, I'm just going to focus on the first point that is more specifically related to demolition. And I'd be happy to come back to the other two questions of modern heritage and urban design in our discussion. So engaging in creative deconstruction instead of feeding urban landfill, what do I mean? So buildings of greater or lesser heritage significance will continue to be demolished. That's a given. And I think as people working in heritage, we need to engage more with theories and practices of deconstruction. Deconstruction, what is that? It's the slowing down of demolition to permit the careful reclamation of all materials for reuse on the same site when possible, or transported to a new use or stored for later. In fact, as the need to conserve resources becomes more and more recognized, and the building stock is starting to be recognized in some circles as an urban mine or urban mining sources, we're likely to see more and more policies for deconstruction. And in fact, Vancouver and Portland have recently introduced requirements for deconstruction when demolition occurs. So in this kind of context, I think one thing is we need to probably be more open-minded about materials reuse, not just curating a few fragments, but adopting more complex, creative approaches that allow for new values to develop as parts of the projects that replace the buildings. So in cases like this, the stained glass windows and the sacred elements were salvaged. But what about all the stone, the bricks, the metal, the wood, all good quality materials, modest enough, but reusable? Where did or well will this discarded material end up? And how could decisions about this material and how it's reused help to release us from a certain amount of our anger and sense of loss, and also the reality of waste? So personally, I know that I'd feel a lot better when I walked past this site if I could see piles of all the material waiting for its reuse in the new building on the same site, including some quite significant pieces like the stone marking the original date of construction. So of course, equally important is the telling of stories of former use, either on the site associated with the loss or in any new location. In particular, when there's a kind of transformation going on where there's a new use that could be quite at odds with the use that was there before. And I think this might be the case here. I think we might need to really reconcile this tower project with what was there before. However, I also think it's important to pay attention to this discussion that's going on in critical heritage thinking around erasure and the fact that going forward, we always need to be able to forget as well as to remember, and to really delve into understanding how a community itself looks at its heritage is an important part of that. So I think the story of what the community did in this case, which was to close up shop when they could no longer afford to be there and move very ceremonially with a march carrying the Torah 10 kilometers to the other side of town, is an interesting contribution to how to think about the subject.
And finally, Mathieu.
Merci, Andrew.
Okay.
Je suis pas aussi éloquent que les gens qui sont devant moi, mais évidemment, je vais parler de certains éléments qui sont de patrimoine et de valeur pour moi. The theme being old buildings, new form, but Andrew making the reference that I wouldn't have even have heard of Madonna. So there's certainly, a young perception. I'm 31, growing up in Sandy Hill, seeing the character of Sandy Hill, but also of the Byward Market, of the Federal Precinct, certainly builds some interest and un cœur vis-à-vis le patrimoine. Sarah touched on something that was really interesting to me, which was historical use, and then she didn't go that far, but she almost said with the modern touch. And I think all the speakers sort of talked, and even the last one on, Susan, on the demolition portion. For me, it made me think of the train station along Rideau Street. Trains were important to Ottawa, even along the canal. And now, what were we talking about? The LRT. Alors, we have a French saying, plus ça change, plus c'est pareil. And I think that's part of the issue in heritage, is how are we able to continue not only to speak of built infrastructure, but the uses that are in them. And this location this evening is actually a very interesting one. Allsaints, that's going through a transformation from a church into where we're standing, probably a future development, and with the protection of the church. There's another one in our community in Lower Town, St. Bridget's. That was the Irish church, now really an amazing cultural space in our community. What you'll see behind me is the Byward Market, and I want to thank Andrew for putting that up. Everyone has a story and a perception about the Byward Market, and it's always challenging to get the viewpoints of residents. I certainly have never lived the car situation that were there. I've also never lived the live cattle, and less do I live local producers in the area. And that goes beyond the built form, but certainly, even looking at the building, Barry Podolsky's work at 55 Byward, and I couldn't imagine with the different perspectives and looks of that property. So what I wanted to do was, I'm going to speak of four themes before, I know I'm short on time, but wanted to speak of four themes and go through certain buildings that give me that vibe. So character, history, the efforts of preservation, and then the future of those properties. And I wanted to start with the University of Ottawa. Tabaret Hall, which is still very functional, the administrative center, and the property nearby, I don't know if you've gone to the new alumni building, the Alex Trebek property. If you go inside, you would never know that it was a heritage property, and when you go outside, you never know that it's changed its use from the inside out. So certainly one of the reflection, and it continues to make me think of the space. There's certainly, if we go back to the Byward Market, the NCC relationship along Sussex Drive, in the courtyards, and that feeling, the historical feeling that provides. We talked about the NAC a little before, but to me, the museum that popped in my mind was Le Musée de la Nature. And now that's changed, and now that's been really an amazing draw for the past few years. And then I'll speak more specifically of struggles. And to me, the struggles that we continue to have are, for example, the cathedral, La Cathédrale Notre-Dame on Sussex. What was behind it, what it is now, a parking lot. And, you know, those buildings are now lost. They're lost for the community. They have no reference point beyond a surface parking lot. The registry building on Nicholas Street, it's kind of like a construction site right now. The jail hostel. The jail hostel that's kind of a non-for-profit. You look at the roof, it's in dire need of maintenance. And certainly the investments from the city and arts court now that are just beginning, and that reuse. So I think that summarizes kind of my feeling. I know there's a lot more that we can discuss. All the themes were a lot more elaborate than I could, but certainly I think I'm bringing reflection on some of the properties. And I'll leave you on that because this one was the theme of the last month, and that's Château Laurier. And interesting feelings towards it. I know that Mark, the heritage planner, is in the audience back there. I'm sure he's interested in the discussion. But I'm thinking of Lord Elgin, Lord Elgin Hotel, and the addition to the Lord Elgin Hotel. I've never heard of issues. I think you really have to look to see that there's been additions on the wings of the hotel. So I'm not making a position or an opinion because there's no application, but certainly I wanted to leave my little 5-minute spiel on that little element, which is Lord Elgin, Château Laurier, both very important to our city. Both have seen expansions, extensions over the years, and there's certainly an interest to know what will the space where that parking garage is, what can that become for an anchor and for the future of that view shed to Parliament Hill and from Parliament Hill.
There was a lot of discussion there. There were a lot of meaty points there. It's a lot thrown at you. But now the conversation turns to you. So what I'd like to do is maybe first if there's questions between the panel to get going, but I'd really be encouraged. I'm hoping that everyone in the room is going to ask a question or make a comment, but just be brief. So we can cover everyone. Oh, except, well. So, pardon? Good. So let's start with the panel, and then we'll turn it over to you. I'll have Noah is right here. He'll have a microphone. He can roam around. And where's Laura? And Laura is over there. She'll have a microphone, and she can come and roam around on that side of the room. So you don't have to get up and so on and so forth. They'll come to you. And just put your hand up, okay? So let's start with the panel. And we're doing well for time. I'm very glad, very happy about that. Let's open it up. Who wants to start? Should I start? There's a hesitation there. Okay. Well, there were some interesting themes there. I think one of the themes that I noticed, because Sarah has mentioned it, my interest is in modern architecture and the architecture of Ottawa in terms of post-war architecture. Definitely her point about, in fact, a lot of the historical fabric of this city is, in fact, in the last 60 to 70 years. The city has transformed. And that this theme about transforming Ottawa is something that I think we talk about, as Mathieu brought in some books about town and crown and these narratives that exist in the city. But in fact, Ottawa is kind of a fascinating city at the edge of, you know, the edge of many things, whether it's on a river or it's on the edge of civilization, perhaps. But it's that kind of transformative effort that has happened, and Grey Bear Plan was a major part of it. I think someone touched on Grey Bear and how the anger or the how that has transformed it, and yet Mathieu has talked about evolutionary coming around where we will have a train station again downtown. I mean, it's these cyclical things. So those are just some ideas. It looks like Susan would like to begin. I'm glad.
I thought you were going to start to talk a bit about modern heritage, and I thought I might pick up on something in that, because I think one of the interesting things as we're talking about additions that we make today is quite often we'll go to a historic building and there will have been additions already that are from the modern era. And they will get removed. And so think about that when we're doing additions today. There's a good chance they will someday be the ones that are getting removed again to take back. You know? And I think there's some interesting dimensions to that to think about.
I have to jump in as you've raised that. It's funny, this may be getting very specific very quickly, but our office is right now involved in at least a couple of projects, and I know other offices are as well, where we're intervening on early conservation projects, where new development is proposed, and where the conservation work or infill was fairly aggressive, and that's certainly presenting a whole new set of challenges. I think there's a really interesting set of challenges. I'd love to continue the discussion about brutalism. I mean, we work a lot with brutalist complexes. You know, there are life cycle issues, there are changing patterns of use, and so we work a great deal with that. And that's very difficult, very challenging, buildings without conventional elevations. But that the intervening where there have already been these modern interventions and late modern interventions, I guess one of the things it's made me do is really take a step back and think about where that hasn't yet happened and how we're actually intervening at these places and thinking about flexibility for the future. I mean, there are lessons, I think, to be learned. So I think that's, we're already there. It's an excellent point of discussion.
Well, and I mean, in terms of renovations now being renovated, of course, there's also the Bank of Canada on Spark Street, which is also a fabulous piece of more contemporary architecture, and going back and the changes that are being made to the changes of the old historic building is something to be considered. But also I want to throw in there the minor renovations, too, that we don't necessarily think of. And I think a lot of the buildings that we're going back to renovate now, and this is certainly true with the brutalist buildings, have suffered from many very thoughtless minor renovations over the years. And so we kind of see them in this kind of hacked together state of temporary minor interventions that haven't thought of the building as, or of those renovations in this kind of bigger sense of renovations. And of course, budgets and timeliness means that we can't always think of renovations and adaptations in this grand scale of what should it be, what does the heritage mean. Sometimes you just need to fix problems.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, good stuff. Noah? Let's open it up a bit. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Go ahead, Michel.
Well, thanks, Andrew. I spent the day with some of you. I have a question for you guys. All good comments. At the end of the day, it's about erasing memory and creating new ones, which sounds kind of nice on the surface. It's organic and lovely. The big question to me is, who decides what I'm going to remember and what I'm going to forget, right? So you've got the architect, the planner, the developer, the bureaucrat, the historian, all at some point thinking that, including myself, that we know better, and we make little decisions, incremental decisions, in spite of codes, rules, and so on. In the office, we say, "Man, this is kind of better. Let's get rid of this, whatever." So, my question is for anyone or all of you: what are your thoughts on the decision-making process, whether it's along the range of full-on community engagement to autocratic rule, right? So who decides and how is that done?
That's a great comment. I mean, I do think when you're dealing with sites that have some area of heritage interest, having consultation, having some kind of collaboration, I think is crucial on that front. And, you know, that's something that we tried to do on the ZB process. We had a number of town halls. We opened the doors. We got people's ideas. Not ideas, you know, I think the idea about trying to design by committee is a disaster, is a nightmare. So we, in terms of trying to open up the doors and having people design by committee wasn't of interest for us, but what we were trying to tease out through that process were, what are the things that really matter? What are those stories that people really want to be told? What are those memories that people really hold on to and want to, as these places get redeveloped and reimagined, what are the stories that they want those things to be told? And so, you know, doing that, we did that throughout the public. We talked to about 3,000 people during that process, but also with the city, and Sally was amazing. You know, the quote earlier on about from the architects sort of saying, you know, all the bureaucracy and the rules and the city planners, what a nightmare they've been. You know, from our perspective, you know, the city had added so much value to the process. And so having those kinds of conversations help then feed into the process, then putting it in the hands of the professionals, but putting it in the hands of the professionals, the architects, and sort of saying, and the master planners and the engineers even, and sort of saying, here are the stories we got to tell, and now it's your job to sort of see how those things get reinterpreted. So I think that is a key element. And Peter Clues, like, I think Peter Clues is a great guy. He's done some good architecture. I've never done a job with him, but you know, I've met him lots of times personally. But I think that's where he probably, you know, could have done a little better, you know, in terms of really opening those things up and engaging that kind of conversation and being really principled about sort of saying, okay, you know, these are the principles, these are the cornerstones we relied on, and here's our end result.
So I guess on the one hand, there's the process at the beginning of a project where one's trying to understand a site, and so there are many avenues to explore there between people's perceptions of place, people's stories of places, various histories of a place, and I mean, as an architectural historian, that's something I usually get involved with, and then I try and communicate that to contemporary architects and sort of connect them to a place in a new way. But when it comes to the stories that get told, I mean, what I find really interesting these days is we're shifting really from a top-down approach to storytelling and a sort of paternalistic approach to, I think, a mode that we're in right now, which is really about creating spaces where stories can be told. People can tell their own stories, people can connect in their own ways to place. So I guess that's really, I think that's changing.
Can I just make a comment on that point too before we leave it? It's that's a great question, Danielle, but I think I just wanted to point out that part of the premise of this evening, I think, is that we have to have a very open-ended answer to your question. I mean, everybody on this panel represents a sort of traditionally acknowledged locus of authority, but the premise of having all these different people in the panel is that that authority can no longer be located in one place, and the premise of inviting the audience to join us and make their comments extends that. So I think that the very premise of this evening is meant to address precisely the question you're asking.
Yes, yeah. My name is Elsie Clement. I'm merely a citizen of Ottawa and interested in these types of discussions. There isn't a style of architecture I don't like. Some of it I think is a little bit odd or whatever, but as long as it has function, beauty, brutalism, you know, I'm good with the facelift, but I like brutalism as well. But my one observation so far is that there hasn't been a lot of talk about architecture and its function. What is the building supposed to represent? Does it represent it from the outside? It doesn't have to. You know, you walk into a building, you're shocked at something that's unique inside. And one of the buildings that is causing me a lot of personal, just kind of thinking through, is the 24 Sussex. You know, people are talking about tearing it down. And then I think, as you said, Susan, the materials that are in that structure and what can you do with it and what is able to be done with it, but also the history of it. The original function of the building was, if I believe correctly, was a private home. It now is the home of, not just the home of the Prime Minister, but it is also a functional, it's also symbolic, but it's also a place that is used for public functions. In fact, larger public functions than perhaps in the day of earlier prime ministers. Any thoughts on, I mean, I've seen some beautiful ideas, but I'm not sure I agree with any of them yet. I'm not ready for that. But I wondered what the panel might be thinking of that.
I worked at 24 Sussex. I used to work for the National Capital Commission, and my job was grounds crew as a summer job, and it was during the years of Paul Martin. That summer, Paul Martin to Stephen Harper, just to give you the kind of the transition in era, and you could see that the building was aging significantly, just from the outside of the property. There's a rear portion which is just a glass gazebo, and even like the attachment to the brick, you could see the age and around the property. I don't know if you knew, but when Trudeau Senior was Prime Minister, he had gotten a pool built. So there's a little pool section that ties into the property, and that had to be condemned because of some water infiltration from the property. So from the inside, you have these massive carpets and these air conditioners that are tied to the windows. So you could see, and there's some cracks in the foundation. There's some elements of beauty, certainly, because it's the massive les pierres. There's massive rocks, masonry. But the building itself just needs a reinvestment, and it's like a political thing not to touch it, right? Because it's seen as like, oh, be frugal, don't spend money on the property. But at some point, if you don't spend for an extended period of time, there's millions of dollars that now need to be invested just to bring it up to standard. A lot of asbestos in the property. Mm-hmm. So maybe that doesn't answer the question directly, well, but it speaks to...
I know that they're not... I don't think the idea is to demolish it. I think it's to do rehabilitation work and some restoration work. What's interesting about your question is in fact that places like the White House in the United States, in Washington, you can go and visit. And when you talk about stories and about the meaning of stories in there, we don't get an experience of that place. It's a private, separate place that's fortified, and unless you broke in and went through a window and then... that you were. Anyway, David, you have a question?
Yes, David Jeans, Heritage Ottawa. Peter showed a picture of Coventry Cathedral, and that started me thinking, because what we were looking at there was a stabilized ruin with a modern building beside it, and that also was echoed in the facadism, what happens when you put in a completely new building, but you save a little bit of the old building. You know, really, the old Ogilvy's store, only about 25% of the facade was put back. But nobody's really been talking about money and the costs of these things. We just heard, you know, 24 Sussex Drive, it's going to cost a lot of money. But look at how much we're going to spend on restoring a decrepit building called the Centre Block of Parliament to its original condition. Look at what we're spending to restore another decrepit building, Union Station in Toronto, again to original condition. Huge amounts of money. And what seems to be missing is preventive maintenance. You know, we have to be investing in our buildings all along, because ultimately we can't afford to spend that amount of money on every single building that we'd like to save. So we need a method of hanging on to things. And the Coventry Cathedral, and again, maybe... would it have been better for the British, instead of building a modern building, to try and reconstruct what that cathedral had been, the way that was recently done in Dresden in Germany, where the church was even more completely destroyed, and yet it's been restored to its original appearance completely at huge cost?
Thanks for noticing Coventry, David. It's a building I got to know fairly well over the last year. And to your question, would it have been better to restore it to what it had been? To my mind, the answer is no. One of the points I made when I tried to sketch out some possible overarching principles for new additions to historic buildings was, I thought each of the examples I showed on the screen showed a clear vision of what sort of relationship with the past and the old fabric and with history the new building needed to have. And I think Coventry is actually a supreme example of that, because, of course, Coventry, for those of you who might not know of it or not have been there, the late medieval cathedral was virtually destroyed during the war in November of 1942, I think it was. And Subsequently, the ruins were cleared and, as David said, stabilized, and then a new modern cathedral was built next to it. And I think the statement, the symbolic statement that really needed to be made at Coventry was new beginning. You know, the past in Coventry was largely obliterated, and they needed to make a statement of new beginning, but a new beginning that retained and respected memory of the past, the memory of the at that time, very recent tragedy that had occurred there. And I think using the ruins of the old building essentially as an atrium, as an entry point to the new building was actually a beautiful, wonderful solution to that need to make that sort of symbolic statement. So to my mind, they got it dead on. And it cost them a lot of money. Yes, was it the cheapest solution? No. In fact, it cost them so much money that they've never completely finished the interior finish of the new cathedral. But still, to retain the shell of the old memory and use it as a point of entry to the new beginning, I think was a beautiful and absolutely perfectly aimed symbolic statement there that was executed brilliantly, to my mind.
In terms of the cost of renovation, I think the main branch is an interesting example to bring up, because the first round of studies in the more recent proposal to remove the main branch and relocate it was actually to renovate the main branch. And there were several studies done that showed that it was possible to renovate the existing branch to meet the requirements that were determined necessary for a main central library. And then it was decided that that was too expensive, so let's spend more money to build a new building. And so the weird ways of, you know, taking the budget and saying that, well, if we're going to spend this much money, let's spend twice as much money and get something new, in the sense that it's the inverse, that it's not that heritage is expensive, but the desire to have something, a new shiny building, is expensive when we have the opportunity to renovate something. And then I also want to point maybe towards Susan's point that I think she was getting towards also these non-architectural ways of preserving history, that we're jumping to the idea that the solution is an architectural solution. And in many ways, there's different ways of telling stories. And so we don't have to pick one way of telling the story, or who gets to pick which story, which was the question earlier. We can pick multiple stories, multiple tellings. Some of those will be resolved in architecture, but there are many other ways to resolve them too.
I just want to build on that to kind of make the point that a few years back when I first heard that the synagogue was going to be demolished, and I was in touch with, at the time it was actually, I think, the Ottawa Jewish Historical Society, and I was interested in doing heritage recording, and they were very concerned that this might mean that I was interested in designation, because they were in the process of trying to, or had just sold it, or in any case, they wanted to do a project of a different kind. But they were very interested that if I was to do heritage recording, that it would involve going through the building with the rabbi and recording what the rabbi had to say. This was actually more important than photography, which was my classic expert approach, come in and take pictures of everything. I think that you have to think about what people are telling you when they're talking to them about what a place means, and it's often not this, it's these stories.
So is the what you're doing in there going to be a reconstruction of what the original? Is it a bit of a interior facadism to fake what was there has already gone? And second, the question is this courtyard, closed courtyard, what is the function of that? You talk about symbolic things, but it never had a symbolic role, that courtyard, beyond providing light to the offices. And also the stories of memories that you associate with these buildings are buildings where no public can ever go, because the security rip-off artists hate the public.
So quite a few, and I should reinforce the fact that it wasn't my project, but one that I was reviewing. But I'd be proud to take credit for that project, but I can't. So Yeah, just to, I guess, you've raised a number of questions. So first of all, people may or may not be aware of the fact that the West Block was very significantly renovated in the 1960s. In some rather detrimental ways. I mean, there was a lot of asbestos added. There was reconfiguration that happened, and so certainly part of the conversation that took place with the project proponents, the architects, the various authorities was what that 1960s layer actually means. There were actually discussions about whether it itself was a value-bearing layer of the building, and so that was certainly, it was not determined to be, but that was certainly a conversation that happened. In terms of what that courtyard is turning into, as you said, it's actually a very functional, it was a very non-functional space. It really wasn't utilized for anything, though the walls of the courtyard were given a very elaborate architectural expression, so it was a space with a great deal of potential, and that space is in fact going to be used in the future to house the chamber for the House of Commons. So it's a really extraordinary transfer. It's an interim use. Longer term, that will become committee space, and so it has an interim, I mean, I wouldn't say short term in that it's at least 10 years, and then longer term it would become future committee rooms. That space itself had no symbolic meaning to people, and most people wouldn't actually step inside the West Block. Having said that, I think everybody in this room would have a strong symbolic connection to Parliament Hill, and certainly to the West Block as, you know, one of the iconic buildings of Parliament Hill, part of the Triad. And so I think most of us would nonetheless have some kind of a connection to the larger site, the larger context, and what's actually happening to it. So I hope that answered some of the questions.
Okay, we've just got two more questions, okay. Mariana, maybe? Or no, there's John, and then Mariana. Okay, and then, okay, we'll... And then after that, we'll wrap it up.
Is this on?
It is on.
Some of you will know I'm a landscape architect. The question is, in the audience, how many other landscape architects in the room? Hands up, none. Well, not unexpected, I suppose, and I guess to ask if you're in heritage conservation is a bit redundant.
I just didn't have a chance to bring a landscape architect on the thing.
Right, okay. No problem, next time. But I was going to say something about Susan Ross, who's a landscape architect in architect's clothing. But Andrew, you remember back in 2003 when we did an urban forum session focused on the Garden of the Provinces and Territories, which has a whole number of stories embodied there. And Sarah, anytime you want to talk about it and tour it, I mean, I'm more than happy to talk about it because we had a really great session then, and I'm a big fan. In terms of views, what I found really interesting about the discussion about the Château Laurier addition, it wasn't so much about the quality of the design. If you look at the NAC and what they're doing there, I recall that there was nary a peep about that addition. It just came out of nowhere and it started to happen. And what was really interesting about it was the fact that it was the views from within the NAC addition out towards National War Memorial and the hill beyond that were featured in the media. And I think that was something that really was a big seller for that, beyond probably the quality of the design, but there are others with more expertise who can speak to that. From a landscape point of view, the views of the Château Laurier from Ottawa Locks or Major's Hill Park are significantly impacted by what they're doing, and I think that's from a larger cultural landscape perspective important to say. And then lastly, I would just say that, and David brought up the point about the number, the dollars that are spent on some of these rehabs, and Center Block is going to blow your mind when you find out what that will be over the next 10 to 15 years. But what I think from the landscape architecture community is the short shrift that is given to the ground plane
in particular. And I'm going to use Spark Street as an example. I'd like to see at least given the credit where credit is due in dollars spent on that. So that's it from a landscape perspective. Thank you for giving me the mic.
When we always try to restore or to add something, but at the same time, it's always difficult. And I think that it's a position to say, well, that doesn't have a value. So there are old buildings that doesn't have value for that person or for the community. And I think that is important to also hear that the other side of the coin that I always, it's difficult. Like when you are a heritage person and you want to preserve the material, preserve everything, it's very difficult. But I think that is I'm very happy that in this panel, Susan mentioned that point, because I think that is also very important also about the money. What is sometimes probably more expensive to preserve something that to build another one. So that's, I think that was a good point to hear about that.
Good, okay.
For me, heritage conservation is intrinsically linked to sustainability and to urban design. And that we're usually practicing heritage conservation within mature areas of cities and, of course, cultural landscapes and rural areas, but I'm just, when we practice in the cities, it's just automatically you are thinking urban design. And sometimes we are asked to be put in our silo as just heritage conservation and just talk about the heritage. And I always rebel against that, and I like to talk about the public realm. But the connection to sustainability, perhaps even more natural to me, that it's the intersection of natural and cultural conservation, preserving that which we value. It's all one and the same thing. Second point, I'll call it gestation. These days, projects get built like that, and there is not enough thought, because there's not enough time for thought. And people were talking about community. I got a whole lot I'd like to talk about that, but in the interest of time, you know, when we did the Bank of Montreal project, there was zero public input, but it went through 4.5 years of design studies and 17 different approval, including experts from across Canada in 3 different panels, and that really helped the entire project. So, but that was time. That was a 4.5 year gestation just for the design. Mm-hmm. So we move at warp speed today, and I think to the detriment of urbanism, heritage conservation, and sustainability.
So I think that's a useful point to sort of say this is a springboard to another conversation. And part of the reason, and this was discussed over a dinner one night, saying why aren't we having these conversations while these projects are coming out? And we are all citizens of the city, and we are all citizens of Canada, so we have both the federal level and the local level to be able to talk about these things. So my goal for this evening is to at least let you take away some of these ideas and then start a conversation. Go on and make your voice heard and have these. And it's partly due to a certain addition to a hotel that hasn't had a lot of real conversation, and hopefully we can sort of go down that path. Now, to do that, first of all, we have to give everyone on the panel a round of applause. So. And then the second step is to actually get up. There's refreshments at the back, and you can mill about for a while. I think we've got time. Yeah, we do. And meet some of the panelists and talk to some of the people who ask questions. There's a lot of interesting people in this room right now. In fact, there's probably thousands of years worth of knowledge in this room right now. So anyway, thank you very much. Thank you much to you, and thank you to the panelists. And...